Jamie, you and I have spoken in the past, and I've often heard you say that tax planning is a year-round thing. As we get into tax season, let's just talk about some of those important dates and deadlines that we need to know right out of the gate.
Well, I think most importantly, you want to file your taxes on time. This year, good news, you have an extra day. Normally, the deadline is April the 30th. That falls on a Sunday in 2023. So you've actually got till Monday, May the 1st to file your taxes. That being said, if you have self-employment income or gig income or anything like that, freelance income from self-employed business, you actually have till June the 15th to file. Either you or your spouse or partner will get that extension. However, if you still owe taxes, the amount that you owe is still due on the normal May 1st deadline.
So let's talk about where you should start. Are you collecting statements? Where do you start?
Well, I think that the most important thing is don't start too early. We've seen people get into trouble when they try to file super early, like the end of February, early March, and they actually haven't gotten all their different T-slips yet. So you're going to be receiving, if you're an employee, a T4 slip. If you're an investor, a T5 slip for your investment income, a T3 if you own mutual funds. There's RSP contribution receipts. I mean, all that stuff will come in usually by the end of March. So a best practice tip is to check last year's return and make sure that if you have pretty much the same investments as you do year after year, you've got all those receipts before you file. And of course, the stuff that you can start doing now is gathering those receipts. So for example, I've got a file that I've kept for all of 2022 with all of the medical expenses in there, all the charitable donations are there. And that way I can sort of assemble that. If you're obviously a self-employed or you've got employment expenses, now is a great time to start getting all those receipts in order for things like home internet. If you're writing off a portion of your home, maybe you've got expenses like utilities. Now is the best time to get all that stuff in order so that come March, you're ready to start preparing your 2022 return or handing that information over to a qualified professional that will prepare that return for you.
We've been talking to various guests here at the Financial Post about RSPs versus TFSAs. From your vantage point, what should you be looking at when it comes to those investment vehicles?
Well, I think, you know, primarily the most important decision, if you don't have enough money to do both, is to really focus on what your tax rate is in 2022 versus what you think that tax rate will be later down the road when you need the money, perhaps in retirement. For most people, if you're in a high bracket when you're working and you're going to be in a lower bracket in retirement, the obvious choice is do the RSP versus the TFSA. Gives you a tax deduction now against your income, which is relatively high. And then when you take them out later out of an RSP or a RIF, your tax bracket will be lower. You'll be ahead of the game. That being said, if you are in the lowest bracket, let's say you're making under $50,000 a year, maybe now is the time to pay the tax on your income. The after-tax amount goes into the TFSA, grows completely tax-free. Then when you take it out later on in retirement, perhaps that amount is completely tax-free. Maybe you're in a higher bracket then. So lots of considerations.
Let's talk about those tax rates and income brackets. What's changed? What's new?
Well, again, the tax brackets are indexed every year for inflation. So again, the good news is when filing your tax return, that's all part of the software. So the software will really take care of all those calculations for you. One thing that we did talk about in terms of going forward for 2023, even though that's not the return that we're filing right now, is the indexation for inflation. We know inflation has been a big issue in Canada. The good news is that all the brackets federally have been indexed by 6.3% for 2023. So that, in other words, even if your income is flat, you'll actually pay less tax in 2023 because the brackets themselves have all gone up by 6.3%, even though the rates have remained the same.
Jamie, when you and I spoke last year following the federal budget, the government had introduced a first-time home buyer's tax credit. Of course, we've been hearing over the last little while about the Canada Housing Benefit. Let's get into some of those tax measures for when it comes to housing.
Sure. Well, I think the biggest one that's really we should talk about is the brand new first home savings account. I mean, this is going to be starting as early as April the 1st, depending on when financial institutions are ready to launch that. And this is a wonderful new opportunity for anyone who's considered to be a first-time home buyer. That means you don't own a home currently or the previous four calendar years, to be able to contribute $8,000 a year for up to 5 years. That's $40,000. Get a tax deduction to the first home savings account, have that money grow completely tax-free for up to 15 years. And as long as you use the funds in that account, this is your contribution, as well as the income and growth to buy that first home within 15 years, the entire amount comes out tax-free. So in other words, this new FHSA combines the benefits of the RSP, which is the tax deduction, with a tax-free growth and the benefits of the TFSA on the back end, because you can take the entire amount tax-free out to buy your first home. So I think this is something that all Canadians that do not currently own a home should look at for 2023.
Let's further get into some of the deductions and credits. I came across the Climate Action Incentive Payment. Who's eligible for that?
Yeah, well, again, this will depend on your provinces. The amount you you will receive really depend on certainly where you live. The good news is this is automatic. There used to be a schedule that you had to fill out. Now, provided that you file a tax return, that's why it's important that even if you don't owe any tax, you should file a tax return every year to get various benefits that are paid to you, things like quarterly GST and HST credits, things like that. This includes the climate action. So if you live in one of those eligible provinces, you should automatically be getting a quarterly deposit into your account or a check in some cases every quarter in respect to the climate action. There's no longer a schedule that is filled out with a tax return.
Lastly, what other deductions or credits come to mind?
Well, I think the biggest one is, I mean, look at me, I'm at home still. I go to work one or two days a week, depending on the week, downtown into our offices, but I'm still primarily working from home. And I would say that was even more so in 2022. So just to remind you, to anyone who is an employee that's working from home, is that there are two methods to claim home office expenses. One is the simplified method, that's $2 a day, up to $500 for every day you work from home in 2022. There is also the detailed method, where you actually track all your actual expenses, things like utilities, internet, stuff like that. And then you prorate that based on the square footage of that you've used in your home. And if it's a shared space, the amount of hours in a week that you work divided by the hours in the week. So again, for most people, $2 a day is the way to go. It's very simple, especially for homeowners, because you can't write off mortgage interest and property taxes. And other than very specific situations, I would say, on the other hand, for a renter who is renting their condo, their home, their apartment, in many cases, the detailed method works well because you get to deduct a portion of that monthly rent. So I think working from home is still a big deal for the 2022 tax year.